My dear teachers, it's time for the next session of Team Orientation Program Top 17 Breaking Barriers. May I request Mr. A. Krishnan, President, SBIOA Educational Trust, to lead Dr. R.W. Alexander Jesudasan to the stage. Thank you, sir. Before I go on to the B4 session, I take pleasure in introducing our guest, Mr. Dr. R.W. Alexander Jesudasan, Principal, Madras Christian College, Chennai. Sir is known for his academic and administrative skills. He is the President of the Madras Science Foundation since January 2015. He is the visiting professor, Liverpool Hope University, Liverpool, UK, since January 2011. He is the recipient of the Loyola Environmental Award from the Loyola College, Chennai, in December 2014, and the International Education Appreciation Award from Pennsylvania Center for International Exchange and Partnership in July 2015. He has attended several conferences abroad. Dr. Alexander Jesudasan proudly says, NCC has been serving humanity through education since 1837. The college has always been at the forefront of providing scholarships to deserving students who are academically strong but hails from economically weaker section of the society. Since 1937, MCC has voluntarily assumed the responsibility of adopting villages adjacent to the college premises and providing education, empowerment and social upliftment to the people living there. I now request Mr. Jesuraj of Madurai Metric to present a memento and a sapling to serve as a token of our gratitude. Thank you, sir. I request Dr. R.W. Alexander Jesudasan to enlighten us on B4, which stands for Breaking Barriers and Building Bridges. May I invite Dr. Jesudasan?
First of all, I would like to thank the management of SBIOA group of institutions for having invited me to come and give a talk, I think for about 45 minutes, to more than 1,000 teachers and administrators who are here in this beautiful hall. It is very difficult to speak after Dr. Rajan. I have interacted with him very briefly, a little earlier, in another meeting. But I'm here primarily expressing my thanks to the school. I'm standing here not just representing the Madras Christian College, but a parent of your alumni. Both my children studied in your school. And one is an HR manager working in Sutherland, my son Anand. And my daughter, Angela, she's doing her medicine. And I would certainly agree with what Dr. Rajana said. Shaping the children in the young stage is very important. And I'm a witness to what SBIOA has done to my children. Shall we give a round of applause? The self-learning mode, the organizing capacity as to what they have to do, all this I'm able to see in my children, particularly in my daughter, who is today a kind of a self-made person. What we need to be providing to them in the young age is very important. In fact, I'll be touching a few points which my predecessor has done here. I will quickly move on to my topic. You would all have surprised, what is this B for? Probably I will ask you, have you seen this B for? I don't know whether you will be able to answer to my question. Probably if you switch on your television channel, there is a channel called B4U. The Hindi songs come there. So I wanted to have a topic title slightly different than the conventional words. And that is why this B4 is bubbling at the moment. It is breaking barriers is the topic, but then I wanted to go a little further. It is not just breaking barriers, but building bridges. That is what is very important. The context in which we are going to be discussing today is to how exactly you can go closer to the children in your class. There will be a lot of barrier, probably to a teacher. I still remember when I entered a college, how difficult it was. And before that, when I was asked to take a seminar in my postgraduate class, where I was a student, how jittery I felt. That is a barrier to face a big audience. Today, why 1,000, why 2,000, even if it is 10,000, I will have no fear. Most of you, I think, would have experienced that, isn't it? We are not born leaders. We are not born teachers. We are not born orators. But we are made. And therefore, we have to break the barriers that are there, mostly with the children. Because you are not just a teacher alone in your class. To some, you may be the mother. You may be the father. You may be the brother. You may be the sister. You may be the friend. Because you do not know the background of the child. The child may come from a very gripping situation, probably which is not known to you. And therefore, we are called to understand the child in the class very closely. And that is why I have titled my talk, Breaking the Barriers and Building Bridges, so that you are able to walk. The child is able to have a close walk with you as a teacher, and you are even a teacher beyond. Now, I would like to applaud the school authorities because they are bringing a large number of people to sit under one roof, which I'm told is happening for the second time. This conclave achieves more than what you are listening to us. The kind of fellowship that you are going to be having during coffee time, during your free time, builds bridges, isn't it? You may have come from Kerala, you may have come from Tiruchirappalli, you may have come from Madurai, but to see each other, to fellowship with each other, I would say, is the largest achievement, even surpassing the lectures that we are going to be giving to you. And therefore, it is very, very important. And once you come closer to each other, under the banner, under the umbrella of SBOIA, nothing can break you. The bonding that builds, probably it may lead to better relationship. You may find partners, you may find relatives, which you will be able to discover only in such an occasion. And therefore, I would like to applaud the authorities for having done this great effort. Now, this talk that I'm going to be presenting probably may be slightly different because it is based on the passion for the profession. Passion for the profession. Dr. Rajan even said that we should not be calling it as a noble profession. This is the mother of all professions. This is the mother of all professions. The President of India would have had his education in a school. You produce the doctors, you produce the engineers, you produce the advocates, you produce the civil architects, so on and so forth. So a school environment is the mother of all professions that are there today. And therefore my talk is going to be how exactly you can have passion for this profession. It is not simply coming, it is not a job, it's not simply coming, doing something and going off. It may call for a second mind. It may call for more passion towards the child. Because I'm standing here not just as the principal and secretary of Madras Christian College, but also someone who takes care of the 5 schools under the MCC Association. Most of you know that we have our school in Chetpet. We have 3 schools over there, and this year we have started a CBSC school, MCC Public School. So I know full well about the school environment. And therefore, whether it is going to be a school or whether it is going to be a college, we need to have passion for the profession. That's very, very important. And only then, you and I can make a difference in the life of the students who are there under our care. Now, when we come to teachers, I think we all were once a student, isn't it? Which teachers do we remember? We remember certainly good teachers. Is that all? We also remember bad teachers. Yes or no? I could find a smile. If you're not able to do your mathematics today, probably I've moved to science, biological science, because of reasons I think you all know pretty well. So we do remember good teachers before us. We also remember bad teachers. We also have 2 categories of teachers. Number one, efficient teachers. What is efficient teachers? Will be able to produce, will be able to give 100% result, will be able to give, you know, students who have scored 500 on 500. Today is the order of the day, isn't it? 498. Production, and probably you might get an award. You are able to give an output. Efficient. This lady is an efficient teacher. This man is an efficient teacher. But what is expected of us? Whether you are an effective teacher. An effective teacher would be rewarded. May not receive an award, but he would be certainly rewarded. He is a person, she is a person who has the outcomes. Today, in the educational pedagogy, how it is interpreted? It is not what is the result. What are the learning outcomes? That is the yardstick that is being used today to assess the efficacy of our teaching. And therefore, efficient, you need to be efficient, you need to be effective as well. Effective teachers are sometimes made. Effective teachers are sometimes born. You say, isn't it? This person is a born teacher. Now, having said, given this introduction, I purposely put this picture to tell you what you are today. I know all of you are having a seat. Our life journey is exactly like a journey that you undertake in a car. I think most of you will be having your cars. Most of you will be driving cars. And when you drive a car, what do? You look through the glass that is there and you drive. And whenever you want to overtake or whenever you want to park your vehicle, what do you see? You see the side mirror. Isn't it? Yes or no? Everyone is keeping quiet. You see that and then you park or you overtake. Our life is exactly like that. When we move forward, today you are here as a teacher. Maybe some of you would have served for 10 years, 15 years, 25 years, or 1 year. Whatever it is, you are in your journey, in your teaching mission. When you are going forward, when you are moving, yes, you need to have the forward, as we said, the vision. But you need to also look at the back, to look at the past. Because the past is also very important. How you have been in the past? Is there any scope for moving forward? That's why I said, before, after. after this conclave, is there any impact in you? Has this brought any change in you? Is very important. And therefore, looking at the past through a mirror and to look forward is very, very important in your journey. And therefore, you are seated here today. You are seated probably not on a bench. You are seated on a chair. And please remember that you are going to be having your strength derived from this bench. And this is what is called is your chair strength, your bench strength. Most of you would have seen these pictures, isn't it? If you go to European countries or if you go to a park, you would find an old rugged seat like that. Some of you would have seated. And they would sit there and probably, and do you know what is there in the mind of these people while one person is sleeping? I don't think anyone is sleeping here. Some people will go there because it's good, breezy, you will be sleeping there. While the two others probably are thinking, probably they are worried, or probably they are planning. Probably some of you are sitting here, maybe thinking, I have served this POA for 25 years. What am I going to be doing in the next 10 years? What is that I can do? Can I make a difference in the life of the children? Or I'm going to be simply a kind of a marketplace to give the degree or to give the certificate of having plus two or 10 standard. And therefore, today and probably in the past 2 days, you are going to be deriving the strength from your chair. And therefore, the chair in that where you are seated is very, very important, because the strength for tomorrow is going to be derived from today. And therefore, I call this as the bench strength. Now, having said that, if our role as a teacher is improper, or probably whatever you have done, or probably what you are going to be doing, if you have not understood the concept of a good teacher, an effective teacher, and if you are not able to do the things properly, it is like a fair shepherd sitting in the midst of starving sheep. A fat shepherd sitting in the midst of starving sheep. All your children will be starving. They'll be thin, they'll be deficient, but you will be very strong. What is the purpose? Or a bouncing doctor when patients are doing well on the bed. This is what is happening, isn't it? When all the patients are doing well on the bed, the doctor will be very happy because he'll be able to make more money. Exactly, it is like that. If we are not doing our duty, if we are not considering our profession with a passion, this is what exactly would happen. And therefore, we are called today to change our attitudes, to change our mode of teaching, our presence in the classroom. If you take, for example, the characteristic of an effective teacher, what do you find? A teacher has to be a good classroom manager. And the teacher has to go into the class with full preparation, to have designed well, to have mastery over what he or she is going to be teaching over there, and should have positive expectations from the student. Because each student comes to the class with a lot of expectation, and you are called to light the candle. If there are 1,000 candles unlit, what does it happen? It does not matter at all. But if one candle is lit among thousands, it provides light. A teacher is exactly like that of the light that comes from the candle. A characteristic of a well-managed classroom is that you ensure that the students are deeply involved in their work. The students should be deeply involved, and it can happen only when they are able to be, when the teacher is involved in the entire exercise. The students know what is expected of them and are generally successful. They know what is expected of them and they want to be really successful. The students are very, very clear, and there is hardly any time that could be wasted. If you have probably some free time, maybe 5 minutes or 10 minutes, probably you can engage them in the day's happening. What is happening in probably science and technology? What is happening in politics? Something very general, you can always share with them. The climate of the classroom is work-oriented, but relaxed and pleasant. Always trying to motivate the children in a way so that they are able to concentrate throughout, and you know pretty well that the level of concentration is supreme in the first 15 minutes and then it gradually breaks down. So with anecdotes, with stories, you can retain the concentration in the student's mind. One hallmark of an effective teacher is that they create a positive atmosphere. I know there are many teachers, whenever you talk, there will be always negative. Isn't it? Even among the colleagues when they speak, this sari is good. If this is worn by someone else, it will be good. But then, always create a positive attitude in the classroom. That is very, very important. Next, as we move on, effective teachers, they will be always praised by the teachers. Even today, I think while we are sitting here, we praise our teachers. Not all of them, some of them, for what they were to you. And particularly if you are a maths teacher, we will ask them, why you took maths? They would say immediately, I was inspired by the maths teacher, the way in which she used to teach. I've taken Tamil because the way in which she used to teach that Tamil has inspired me, has influenced me. And therefore, we need to be in that particular category of our students praising us for what we have been. As we prepare our lessons, I think first of all, we need to understand, because I know I've been a teacher for the past 35 years. Some topics before I could teach, I would read and reread 10 times, 20 times, 30 times. And you need to internalize what we are going to be speaking to our children, what we are going to be teaching to the students. You need to motivate them, because the students have high expectations. And as you know pretty well, that a teacher is always a ladder. We enable our students to not just be at our level, but even to cross us and go higher and higher in life. And therefore, this is very important. And the next important aspect of an effective teacher, you should encourage our students to ask questions. I have seen many, many teachers, when a question is asked, they will not encourage. They will say, Tamil enna sonna kanna theriyum, what do you know? Keep quiet, shut. I think today what is lacking in our situation is that we should enable our students to have a questioning mind. Why it is like this? Why it is not like this? And that would actually inspire them and motivate them. As we look at some of the characteristics of a teacher needs to be a reflective teacher. The person has to be open-minded, the person has to be wholehearted, the person has to be caring for the relationship. And therefore, a person, a teacher, has to have even this important virtue of being a reflective teacher. Coming on to the student, what is good teaching? Is it, today we know, if people have to score 500 or 500, what has to happen? I really pity, you know, the children who have to simply vomit so that the comma has to be there. Only then they'll get the full mark. And the preposition has to be there, they'll get the full mark. We know. And without high marks, they can't probably enter into professional colleges. But then, what is important is that this by heart, the rote learning method has to be changed. Education should be an area where we meet with each other, the teacher and the student, and meet with each other, and there should be an element of discovery. We have heard from Dr. Rajan, a great scientist of international repute. Discovery, that discovery mind has to come in. And as I said already, I like to go beyond. A classroom or a teacher is not a shopkeeper. A teacher is not a shopkeeper giving you the certificate for having passed third standard or fifth standard. It's not that you go into SPOA and purchase the certificate for having passed 10th standard. A teacher is a gardener. Dr. Rajan also mentioned that. You have to add water. You have to add organic manure. you have to add water, you have to give the nutrients. A teacher is a gardener, and education is not that you go into a university, you go to a college and purchase the degree. Coming on to the teacher characteristics, the teacher first of all should love the subject. Probably today, if you ask our children, why did they take engineering? They would say, I have been forced to take engineering. In fact, in our college, we get students who discontinue engineering after 2 years and coming and joining our institution for arts and science. And because the child did not love the subject, the teacher basically should love the subject. And oftentimes you would say that research is done in universities or in colleges. But I want to tell you that research acumen is already there in the child. Probably the child enters very early class. Why? Even a child of 1 year has the research acumen. The kind of gestures, the kind of questions, the kinds of inquisitiveness that you are able to find in a child all clearly reveals that research attitudes are already there in the children's mind, and we are here to groom them. We are here to provide the necessary input. Knowledge in the discipline has to be made into an adventure of life. It should not be made into a kind of a compulsion. And this is there, or this should be there in the hands of every teacher. We should make any subject an adventure, a very joyous journey, whether it is going to be history or geography or science, it has to be a beautiful venture. Coming on to the teacher and students, the teacher not only should love the subject, but also should love the students. Sometimes students may be silly. Sometimes students may be silly, they will ask silly questions, but do not snub them. Do not snub them. I'll give you an example. In our college, when there was one Scottish principal, and even now we have prayer every day in the morning where all students are welcome. One day a student went, because in a week, 2 days, students lead the worship, and 2 days, the professors lead the worship. One day, the student was taking the prayer, and he was praying and praying and praying. The bell rang, and it still extended. He did not stop. At last he stopped after 5 minutes, after the bell has rung. The Scottish principal was there, and he asked him, I believe, you know that the bell has rung and you have been praying. And he said, no, God asked me to pray, I prayed. So this gentleman, Reverend McVeigh, said, God asked me that the bell has rung and the classes has to begin. You see how the message has been communicated without snubbing the child, without snubbing the student. Therefore, you can have your humor, you can have a joke to convey what is not right, but never to snub the student and show aspects of love towards the students. Teachers must teach, encourage, reward, at the same time detect any bad conduct and correct the student whenever it is possible. The most important one, I said teacher loving the subject, teacher loving the student, teacher loving colleagues. I think this is a very difficult task, isn't it? Yes, sir. Isn't it? It's a very difficult task. We may say yes now, but when I come into your institution only, I'll be able to know. Now, in fact, my predecessors have said to me that in a college, we don't have, even I would say the same thing, I don't have any problems with the students. We deal with 8,000 students at a time in our college. But I want to tell you, the problems that come from the students are hardly any. But the problems that come from colleagues, almost every day I will have one. Either there will be problem between the head of the department and the teacher, or there will be problem between the colleagues, and today you know what all can happen. And therefore I cannot rule out the possibility that everything is fine. First of all, we need to love our colleagues. We need to consider them as ours and move on. And every teacher is indispensable. Every teacher is important in a school. Whether it's going to be physics teacher or mathematics or physical education, every teacher is indispensable because they all contribute to the growth of the institution. Let me move a bit quickly. The value of teachers, I think you all know pretty well. I will just simply read. If you remove salt from the sun rays, then nothing remains. If you remove mud from the mud pot, then nothing remains. If you remove cause from the effect, then nothing remains. If you remove teachings of our teachers, then nothing of us remains. That is the value of a teacher. And therefore, the value of teacher can never be forgotten. Now, I'll give you a few clippings because I mean, you would have got bored by my talking up to now. I'll give you two clippings which will really motivate you, because a teacher, as I told you, you also lead the students. You are also a leader. You should not forget that. And therefore, there are a couple of clippings which I would like to show you, which would be of interest to you. I hope you all know this lady.
Oh, great question. I've always talked about my 5 C's model. Let me talk about them again. The first is competency. I think anybody who wants to be a future leader should have a hip pocket skill. That everybody looks at and says XYZ is the go-to person for that skill. Because unless you really know for something, and not just as a generalist, you don't stand out from the pack. But in order to be competent at something, you've got to be a lifelong student, because you've got to constantly refine your knowledge of that subject so that you remain ahead and abreast of everything that goes on in that field first. The second I'd say is courage and confidence. It's a pair. You can be very, very competent, but if you're not willing to speak out, if you're not willing to have the confidence based on your knowledge, what's the point? Right? You just roll over. So courage and confidence are very important. The third is communication skills. You cannot overinvest in communication skills. Written and oral communications, because as a leader, you constantly have to mobilize the troops. I can tell you, when I first came to the United States, I used to debate and I used to be on debating teams, but I used to speak so fast, because culturally I grew up in an environment where people spoke very fast. Fortunately, Yale had a requirement that unless you passed the communications course, you couldn't graduate from the first year or the second year in business school. I flunked the first time I took the communications course. So over summer, I took it again, which was the best thing that happened, because I learned to sync my brain with my output from my mouth, so I started to slow down what I was saying. Huge difference. So I encourage all of you, invest in communication skills, critically important. The fourth skill I'd say is consistency. It's important that leaders are consistent. You can change your mind, but change your mind against a consistent framework. Because if you're not consistent, people are always second guessing what you're doing. So be consistent. And the last skill is your compass. Integrity is critical in this job. You can be competent, you can be courageous, have confidence, be a great communicator, be consistent. But if you don't have integrity, that compass doesn't point true north. Everything comes crashing down, as we've seen in recent times. So again, it's the 5C model, and that's what I've operated against for all my life.
This lady, I think you would know, she's Indira Nui, Indira Krishnamurthy Nui. She studied BSc Chemistry from Madras Christian College, 1971 to 74, and she's now the CEO of PepsiCo International. And this is the 5C model. How nicely she has encapsulated the 5 C's. Competence, communication. Is it not true to us? I think it is very much true to us. If you want to be an effective leader, if you want to be an effective communicator, as I said, you're also a leader, and you need to have these 5 virtues. And only then you can be a successful teacher. In fact, recently she came to the Madras Christian College, and she endowed a huge amount for the development of the chemistry and physics laboratories of the Madras Christian College. She returned her gratitude to the college in no small measure. The next important clipping that you would see would certainly encourage you to develop certain important aspects, and this is there for you.
There are 3 things in life that makes the person successful. One is the knowledge the person has, the skills he develops, and the attitude he has. It can be demonstrated by a very simple experiment of balancing skill a person need to possess. And then knowledge and skills are individual to the person. They live with him and die with him. They cannot be passed on. But they can be connected to the society or the organization through another agency called as the toothpick. If you can see, the forks are hanging free on the edge of the glass with a toothpick. If you see, 3/4 of the toothpick is outside the glass, a small portion is inside the glass. Now what should happen if I burn the toothpick from inside? Watch carefully. I start burning this toothpick. What normally people expect is, as the toothpick burns, the wood burns and the whole forks will fall down. It would not happen. Try to take another matchstick. I'll try to burn it. The inside of the toothpick. Not two. Even if you take 20 matchsticks, it will not burn beyond that. If you observe carefully, the toothpick is balancing on the edge of the glass, which is not even 1 millimeter thick. Two heavy forks are balancing on that. This is most important for us. Your knowledge and skills are important. But what is most important is the attitude which connects you to society and organization. Among the three things that I have, glass, fork and toothpick. Toothpick is fragile, it can be burned. That means in your life your attitude is more tested than your knowledge and skills. If your attitude is burned, in spite of being burned several times, it will not drop your knowledge and skills. Please watch carefully, I slowly lift the glass up now. You can see. Still knowledge and skills are held together by the attitude. Now I push the attitude out. When I push the attitude out, the knowledge and skills also fall down. Therefore, the most important aspect in life for success is not the knowledge, not just the skills. It is the attitude a person can use. Ultimately, that holds him in difficult times and makes him successful in good times.
Friends, I think you would agree with me. You may be a big expert in your own field, knowledge. You may have skills with you, but then the attitude is very important. Attitude is more important than aptitude, because attitude decides your altitude. To which level you want to go up in life, I think it is the attitude that decides your altitude. There are people, you know that, they'll be remaining in the same stage forever and ever because the attitudes do not permit them to move higher up in the ladder. You need to inculcate these values in the minds of your students. Attitude, positive attitude towards life is more important. And if attitudes are there, you can certainly go up in the ladder of life. The next important one for a good teacher is you need to teach, you need to educate the heart. Education of the heart is the heart of education. Whatever you are teaching them should not be going into this ear and going out. Educate, whatever you teach should go into the heart. Should go deeply into the heart. Because it's not just physics, chemistry, mathematics that you are teaching. Along with that, the values, the principles have to go in, and therefore these have to sink in. They have to get sedimented in the heart, and therefore education of the heart is the heart of education. For that, the teacher needs the art of education. You need to have the heart, you need to have the skill to reach the heart, not just to reach the brain. And therefore, the education of the heart is the heart of education. Only then you can produce youth, you can produce citizens to the country and to the world who would be value-based people. Otherwise, you'll be simply sending robots, you'll be simply sending people with no heart. Their focus, their intentions will be certainly different. But the need of the hour is to have education of the heart, which is the heart of education. I made my own formula of H3 and E3, which will make you the B4. The education that we offer to our children should not only go to the head, should not only go to the heart, but should be revealed in action, the hand. So the education that we are intending is for the head, for the heart, and for the hand. Whatever you have learned, whatever values, whatever you have learned in any field, has to be put in action. Otherwise, it is zero. It is no use. You know, this is the problem. This is the problem in most of us. We may have the knowledge in our head, but you know, the longest distance in the world, what is the longest distance in the world? Or the time to reach the longest distance, it may be from Sydney to California, you may say so. That would take the longest time. But I want to tell you, the longest time that is taken is to travel from the head to the heart. You would have conceived that you may have intentions to do good to someone. It may remain only in your head. You may have a desire to teach well as a teacher. It may remain, you may would have prepared well, but it is there only in the head. Only when there is passion, it can reach the heart. And therefore, my dear teachers, my dear friends, please have that formula that when you teach, when you go to the class, you should not only touch the head, you should not only touch the heart, but then you should enable. That is why the praxis comes, the practical comes in any area. I think you should be able, you'll be able to facilitate them, to put them on practice. Education, what is the intention? It is to emancipate, it is to empower, it is to enablement. And therefore my formula is H3 plus E3 should be you are breaking barriers and you are building bridges. I think this is the formula, because you know teachers will be able to remember things very well through the formula. I thought we would have this particular formula. I am almost come to the end. All these things, mind is very important. What did you understand from this slide? You thought that there is a problem, isn't it, in the PPT? Or you thought there is a problem in the audio system? No, it is not a problem. This projection reflects your mind. Reflects your mind. And how it is being explained? I've kept a radio there and it is still in the process of tuning. When the tuning is imperfect, you know, Radio 1, Radio City, 91.1, 91.9, 94.3, 93.5, Surian FM, 106.4, Hello FM. I think these are things that you know. Only when the frequency is obtained, you are able to get the music. Otherwise, when the tuning is imperfect, you get irritated. I think most of you have got it. Innada idu karakaran kekkudhu satham kekkudhu paattu kekkudhu, nothing is clear. This is exactly, you know, our mind. As a teacher, if our tuning with our Almighty is imperfect, eventually, you know, our tuning is important. Because this is a noble profession, and if the calling, teaching profession is not like any other profession, it is a calling of God. And if your relationship with God is imperfect, your mind will be distorted. You will go to the class unprepared. You will be doing something, you will be rattling with words the students cannot understand. Because your mind is confused, your children's mind is also confused. And therefore, tuning with God, tuning with others is important. And this is what is done through motivation. And this is what will happen if tuning is perfect. You know, when all the violins are synchronized, what do you get? You get a beautiful music. This is what happens in an orchestra. All the, you know, music, all the instruments are tuned. And this is what I think you should need to consider whenever you go to a class.
There are 40 people, there are 40 orchestra people sitting there, you need to understand.
And this tuning is important. And when you do the tuning, when it is perfectly tuned, you will be able to enjoy the music. Every class should be a class of enjoyment for both the teacher and the taught. And it is possible only with the tuning vertically and the tuning horizontally with your students and colleagues, and all the things that I've said is there. And this is possible only when there is passion. Only when there is passion for the profession. I've almost come to the end. Only when there is passion for the profession, you can blend with your students. And the beautiful music will arise from your discourse with your children. And this is what I think you find. Is it a passion for the profession? Our President of India is a professor, basically. I think you know that. Dr. Radhakrishnan, a student of the Madras Christian College, became the president. And they all have been very efficient, effective teachers, basically, because they had passion for the profession. One last word. I think teachers are going to be judged more strictly. This is from the word of God. Because if you have faltered, we'll be subjected to greater punishment. And therefore, this is also a kind of a word of advice and a word of caution. Teachers, because we are the ones who are creating people for other professions. If you and I are faltering, we are more answerable, we are more accountable than other professions. Probably can an advocate can escape, I think you know that. Probably an engineer can escape, probably the building which collapsed in Mughalivakam, I think he can escape. Or probably a doctor can escape, but not teachers. He will be judged more strictly than others. My last word to all of you is probably the acronym which I have created. Which I have created. Ever. Excellence. E for excellence. R for relevance. E for excellence and R for relevance. You are all working for SPOE. Your trump card, your major motive would be that you have to be an excellent teacher. You should strive for excellence. At the same time, you should be relevant. Because if you look into the education scenario in the past so many decades, it has changed a lot. It has moved from the traditional system of guru-shishya relationship to board and chalk, to overhead projector, to slide projector. Today you have smart boards. And you, the teacher, has to change through times. You have to be relevant, not only in technology, in every aspect, particularly in relating you to the society. You should be relevant. And therefore, let these two be your hallmarks as you work in SPOE school. That you will strive for excellence and relevance. And therefore, who is responsible for excellence and relevance in SPOE? If I ask you this question, what you would say? It is not my job, sir. I think the principal is responsible for excellence and relevance. The second-hand correspondence is responsible for excellence and relevance. It is the job of this person. It is the job of that person. No. No. Who is responsible? We are responsible. Shall we all say it together? We are responsible for excellence and relevance. If our institution is coming down, we are responsible. But let us take it in the positive sense. If SPOA has to be number one, has to be excellent, Alexander is responsible. Jacqueline is responsible. You put your name. I am responsible for the excellence of SPOA. I am responsible for it. Own the institution in your heart. Own your institution and say, I am responsible for the betterment of this institution. I should work hard for this institution. And therefore, with this, I think, coin word, I think with this important keyword for your life, excellence, and you can apply it in any situation, I think it will be relevant. With these words, let me say to each one of you, how delighted, how happy I am this morning to come and say thank you to SPOA, because you have given me two educated children. They studied here, and as a kind of paying back,
I have come here to share my little experiences on education and what is good education, how you could be an effective teacher, how you could be a passionate teacher, and I would like to thank each one of you for your patient listening, and I'll be too glad to take questions. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.